Okay, so for the people who don't know me, my name's Alan Morris. I work, I'm head of sales for Bayer Environmental Science and have been for the last 3.5 years, but been working for Bayer, well, through Agravo and Aventis and all the other names we worked under for about the last 14 years in this industry. So today, the next two items on the agenda is to give you an update on what's happening with rodenticides and more specifically about what's happening with rodenticides with Bayer and also what's new. So I'm probably going to sort of mould the two in together. So and there'll be a little bit about a quick update on the insecticides after that as well, but very brief couple of minutes. So over the next sort of half an hour, 40 minutes, keep with me. Coffee is on the way, okay? Okay, so rodenticides and Bayer over the years have not really gone together. A lot of people know us for, in the UK, and I do stress the UK, for insecticides and being the leading manufacturer in insecticides in the UK. For years, some people will know this, but on the continent, we have been big players in rodenticides. And it's my pleasure today to be able to bring you some key information about rodenticides and the way forward. So, in my slides, there's about 20 slides here. I'll cover a little bit about resistance, so some of you will know this. I'm going to try to break this down into simple, understandable English, which even I can understand. Take you on the sort of key features and benefits of the new products. I do say products, plural, that we're bringing through and are available shortly. Cover a bit of the usage and application. I don't think there'll be too many surprises there. You know, why rats and mice are different, and then summarise it and then take any questions. If there are any questions, because there'll be some science in here that I'll again try to make reasonably straightforward. If you have a question, just stick your hand up any time throughout the next half hour or so, and I'll see if I can answer it. But this is pretty much hot off the press. There's a lot of things here that literally 2 weeks ago we got the registration officially for these products, okay? So, resistance in the UK, it's well publicised, and as Ian's already mentioned, especially in these parts of the world, about resistance in rodents. So, there are a lot of terms here, and I must admit, when I started looking at all the terminologies and the science behind it, all these code names and everything, it absolutely means nothing to me, if I'm honest. So what I've tried to do here is sort of just give you some headline things about, there is something called the Scottish strain, which has a code behind it, and there's some explanation of what that code is, but I won't bore you with that today. There is a Welsh strain of resistance for rodents in the UK, and these aren't just, they have, should we say, British names, but these are commonly throughout Europe and the globe. So the same genetic mutations happen in other parts of the world as well. We have the Gloucestershire strain. We have the Hampshire-Berkshire strain, which is probably the most famous one, I think, in the industry. There is the Kent strain. And there are several other mutation strains of resistance which are scientifically proven. So if people say there isn't anything as resistance, they're lying. At the moment, the industry, and I think this is always the problem with our industry, because we, again, as Ian's mentioned, we are quite a small industry in the big scale of things. The money hasn't been there in the past to actually find out at what level that resistance is. But there are things like tails being tested to check resistance, etc., etc. So, you know, we're doing the best with the resources and the tools we have today to actually develop strategies going forward. I have to say also, on a resistance front, there are a lot of things where people think they've got resistance, and actually sometimes it's just down to the actual application. So you always have to take resistance with a pinch of salt. But in the areas where we know there is resistance, we have a new product called Rodilon, okay? And the new key features and benefits. So this is something based on a new active ingredient. There is no known resistance for Rodilon formulations across the planet, okay, and I have to stress that. It's not just the UK, it's a new active ingredient into the UK, but this is something that's being sold around the world for many, many years. So it is a pioneering new active ingredient, and it's the first really active ingredient to be introduced into the UK for the last 20 years, and it is the most recent active ingredient that's been identified to kill rodents in the last 20 years, and would you believe since 1989? Okay. So the industry moves fast. With the Rodilon formulations, the HSC have said it's for indoor use only. Okay. With the formulations, we're not just bringing one formulation through. We're bringing four different formulations through. And you'll see some of the suffixes for the brand name. So we have a Rodilon Wheat Tech, which I'll come on and give you a bit more details about each one and where you could use them. There is a Trio, which is a very unique formulation for mouse control. You have blocks, and then you have soft blocks. So basically, when we talk of soft blocks, we're talking like a pasta bait. Okay. They are all highly palatable and effective single feed solutions. Okay. We are using the highest grade of food contents into these to make them the most palatable in the most toughest environments. We're not scrimping at all on trying to get cheap ingredients to push out. It's to make sure you get high effectiveness from these single feeds. So I'm going to try to explain, and we there was probably three or four of us in our office the other week trying to understand DNA and mutations and what actually happens of how you get resistance. So I'll try to see if I can explain it. Basically, when you have an enzyme in the rodent's blood, which just keeps circulating around in the system. And what you have is, when you get a rodenticide, if you see this sort of diagram here, you have a nice fit here, and this is simplified for the presentation. What happens when you have a rodenticide is the rodenticide basically comes in and sticks onto the enzyme, which then stops the enzyme clotting, which obviously then lets is what actually kills the rodent. What happens is when you have a mutation, and also what happens here is when the rodenticide sticks in, this is like a balloon. So you push one area and another area gets distorted. So that stops these two bits coming together. So with a rodenticide, the rodenticide gets put in here. The two connections of the enzyme cannot make, so you get the clotting process does not happen. When you get mutation, we came up with the analogy in the office of, if you have a glove, the rodenticide fits perfectly into the enzyme. Okay, so you get all five fingers in. If that enzyme changes, mutates in this stage, that you can't get your full hand in. The difference is, and that's where you get resistance, and a lot of the common rodenticides that are being used today don't work because they can't bind to the enzyme to stop the clotting process. With Rodilon, it's much more flexible. What happens is you don't need all five fingers placed into that glove to actually get the rodenticide to work. If you only can get one in, it still binds to that enzyme to actually stops the clotting process. And that's why there is no known resistance for difenthiolone across the planet. And this has been working for 20 years. So it's not a new thing we expect resistance to come. We don't, because it's successful for at least 20 years so far to date. And we still don't have any cases of resistance.